Monday night, so that means it's time for Monday Night Sports Talk on the AirNetWord.net. Welcome in, everybody, as we head towards spring. Hopefully, you've got those clocks straightened out by now. If not, hey, chances are you're probably late for even work today. One guy that's not late any time, give him the time, and he'll be at least there if he's not busy. Chad States with me live at this moment from Huntington via Skype. Chad, how you doing?
We're doing fabulous, Greg. How are you?
I'm fine. I know you're about to get into your busy season of the year with Interleague Baseball. When do you guys get started, and are you working out already?
Well, I should be, but I'm not. My 43-year-old butt will be trying to hurl pitches at an alarming rate next week, and probably not be able to do too much with that.
But, man.
We start next week.
Yeah. Do you actually get tired? I guess you would, because if you're the batting practice the pitcher as opposed to a machine, I guess you could wear your arm out real quick, huh?
Yeah, it doesn't take long, specifically in the early season here when it's cold outside.
Oh, exactly.
You know,
exactly.
I haven't done much since then, so yeah, it gets pretty dicey early on, that's for sure.
All
right. When it gets to be 80, 90 degrees outside, I can throw all day long. But in this cold weather, I do not do well.
It takes a while to warm up. So
we've got
Interleague Baseball starting soon. Also, we have Little League Baseball. Of course, it'll be Pledge Day soon. The kids will be out looking for donations. And you know what, Chad? I just talked to somebody last week. They've got a new girls softball league starting in Huntington. And I'm hoping to get the gentleman involved in that on the air with us, either by getting him on our talk show during the day, or maybe we'll bring him on Monday Night Sports Talk next week. But I'm intrigued by that. Yeah,
as I say, it's tied to the Huntington Little League, so it's actually a Little League girls softball league.
Exactly.
So
yeah,
should be good.
And I know I've heard of those leagues before, you know, throughout the country, affiliated with Little League. So Huntington will get their first taste, and you know, all dads take their little girls out and throw the ball from time to time, and it's kind of neat now that the girls will be able to get competitive to some extent. So. Looking forward to that. Hey, meanwhile, Chad is with me now. Hopefully, Dave Shannon will be jumping on later on this evening. If you'd like to jump on and talk about anything with us, give us a call, 814-242-4845. Again, that number, 814-242-4845. All kinds of stuff to talk about this evening, including the NCAA bracket. We'll get to those in just a few moments. But let me start with this, Chad. Martavis Bryant, who was actually suspended, you know, kind of like for four games last season, I believe at the beginning of the Steelers season. Now we get news that he's suspended for the whole season. Give me your thoughts on that, and then we'll kind of kibitz back and forth here.
Well, he's suspended, obviously, for the use of illegal drugs within the NFL's policy. The thing that I find very curious with this is how quickly he just bellied up to saying, hey, I used something that is an illegal substance. Now, when you look at the set of circumstances, and this by no means forgives him for what he did. I think you have to know better as an individual what you could put in your body as an athlete legally and be able to play football. But with that said, I think we're dealing with Bryant being a troubled soul, so to speak.
Yeah.
You know, you never really know what's in somebody's head. And what coping mechanisms they need to be able to get themselves through.
Right.
Do I really think that this is an issue of him just being out and being, for lack of a better term, a crackhead or something like that?
No,
I don't. I think you're looking at a troubled individual that was using some sort of form of narcotic to help get himself through situations that he can't deal with.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, he owned up to it. I'll give him all the credit in the world and the fact that he just said, you know, hey, I'm checking myself into rehab. I'm accepting. I mean, there was no fight with him whatsoever when he did this.
Right.
What I hope for is that he's able to go in and get the help that he truly needs the right way and come out a better person when this is all said and done. So I am by no means looking at this as Martavis Bryant being a performance-enhancing drug, trying to make sure that he's bigger, faster, stronger on the field, or something that he's just out being a partier. This is a much more disturbing part of life that he's going through, and I think we, as sports fans, kind of need to back his play a little bit on this and help him through a situation.
Well, you know, I'm glad you said that, because just a few moments ago, the word just came down that not only was he very forthcoming when he went to the league and told them he was taking drugs, but we find out also now in further reports, and I'm glad I didn't jump the gun, he has a problem with depression, and he's heading into rehab to address these problems. Now, I got to be quite honest, if without that knowledge, which, you know, his manager agent put that information right out there in a report released about an hour ago. Knowing that now, dude, you were you thinking early on, without any information regarding Martavis, that perhaps the Steelers should just dump him? Because now this is the second time. Obviously, they had to have knowledge that maybe he was dealing with some other medical problems.
Yeah, I don't know that I made that call. The reason why I was able to talk about what I talked about there earlier was I had read an earlier report, I want to say this morning, if not last night, that said that something like this was going to come out. So the very first instance where I saw that he was going to be suspended, I read an article that said that it might be for reasons along these lines. So I didn't get the chance, Greg, to honestly jump the gun.
Yeah.
I kind of figured it was going to play out the way it just played out.
Okay.
You know, had I not known that.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think you're obviously your mind, specifically in today's world with today's athlete, takes you to the fact of, well, you're just a bonehead. You can't get it together. You need to go. I.e. like Johnny Manziel or something like that, but that's not the case with this guy. So, you know, I want to give him credit for stepping up, because that's a hard thing to admit to, specifically if you're a man and a football player all wrapped into one. That's not an easy thing to wrap your hands around. So let's hope that he gets the help that he truly needs and that he's able to make it out okay and then make it back into the field with open arms, because this is a great spot where somebody truly does deserve a second chance because of the set of circumstances.
Right, and I agree with you. In many instances when that occurs, as in the Manziel case, I think we were all ready to jump on, hey, you know what, at least Johnny had gone away for rehab, whatever that situation was. We still haven't understood that fully, but then he came out and had problems again. In this case, this morning I hadn't gotten the report about what Martavis had done, other than he was being suspended on perhaps drug use. And I guess I kind of jumped the gun, because the first thing I said on the morning show was that, oh, well, I don't think the Roonies are going to put up with that without having the additional information. And I'm glad we have that now. And Martavis actually can get on and, you know, take care of his personal life. That gives him a year to hopefully get it together. Now, do you think when you're off for a year, because Dave and I were talking about the Sharapova situation last week, where it was announced that she was being suspended from tennis. You think that Martavis has a chance to come back after sitting out a year, Chad? I mean,
sure. It's all dependent on whether he's willing to accept the help that he's given.
Okay.
If he's able to absorb the information and the help that he's able to get by going through the process that he's going to go through, absolutely, he's going to be able to make it. Johnny Manziel had the same opportunity, correct?
Yes, he did.
He had the same opportunity. He checked himself into something, and what did he do? He came out, and he burned right through it.
Yeah.
And, you know, so I hope – now, that's a whole different situation.
Right,
That's a party animal that cannot contain himself, as opposed to a guy who is suffering through a mental illness. And those can be some dark and bleak days that Martavis is going through.
Right.
And let's hope that he is willing to accept what he is and what he's going through, and that he's able to make that step change in his life to put it all back together again, or to actually, I mean, maybe not even to put it all together again, it might be wrong, to know that he can accept it and there are different ways to cope with it, as opposed to using what he was using to try to do that.
And I got to believe, you know what, the fact that he took the initiative to come forward and to be forthright with this whole thing, I think he'll be okay. I think he'll get the help. I think the Steelers are going to do everything they can to make sure he gets the help and that he gets healthy and maybe learns how to cope with whatever that problem is. We don't know. Having seen some athletes in the past who have a shyness about them, that have certain personality traits, you know, not every football player, or you could probably attest to this, Chad, not everybody is so outgoing. You know what I mean? I remember having a conversation with a young man in high school who was being interviewed all the time, and he kept his head down, and he said very little. When he got to college, a D1 school, I said, you know what? When they do these interviews, you're going to have to learn how to speak up. And he shied away from that. When he got to the NFL, he spoke very softly as well. And that's what happened in the case of a guy who actually played for the Cardinals, you and I know, and then he went to the Steelers. And he was always shy. And I guess that's all right, you know. And people don't understand Not everybody has an outgoing personality. Not everybody wants to be in front of the camera. And Martavis could have a problem with dealing with things like that, plus the depression. So we wish him well. Now, let me ask you this, Chad. I just touched on the Sharapova thing. Dave and I talked about it off air last week. She supposedly was taking heart medication. They just enacted this thing in January, okay? So do you believe that she should be suspended for those 2 years? And if she's suspended, what's her chances of ever coming back? You know, because tennis pros have to play.
Here's the thing. Do I believe she should be suspended?
Right.
Yes.
Okay.
It is your obligation as an athlete to check what is illegal and what is not.
Okay.
If you have to, I mean, it's your job.
Right.
So yes, I do believe that she should be suspended for not doing that. Same as I believe that Martavis Bryant needs to be suspended for doing what he did.
Right.
With that said, do I think that there was malicious intent by Sharapova to do what she did?
No,
I do not. And that's what separates, you know, was there intent with Roger Clemens taking steroids so he could pitch longer?
Yeah,
yes.
Obviously.
Was
right.
there intent with Barry Bonds? Oh, wait, never proved it. Yes, it did.
Yeah.
No, they didn't. Whatever. Yes, there was.
Right.
Is there with Sharapova?
Yeah.
No. There isn't.
She had been taking that medication all along.
I mean, by her coming forthright and saying, hey, but she owned it.
Yeah.
You got to give her credit. She owned it. But you still made a mistake, and the WTA still needs to, regardless, they still need to punish her the same way that they would punish anybody else.
Okay, listen. Now, in our discussion here, Sharapova took this medication for years. Then they enacted it, put it on the list in January, okay?
Yep.
Then apparently she gets suspended, I believe it was in February, matter of fact, or early March.
Yep.
Do you think WTA will give her some leniency based on the fact that she had already been taking this medication?
There's got to be some give and take there. But the problem is, once you start building in exceptions, it gives you the loophole to say, well, hey, you did this for her. What about for me?
Yeah.
So while I think that would be a novel thing for them to do, I don't think they'll do that. And I don't think that they should.
Okay.
Again, it's that athlete's responsibility. She owned it.
Yeah.
She knew it. And it's not like, you know, Maria Sharapova is going to be hurting for anything.
Oh, no.
She can go out and, you know, model for whatever she wants to.
Right.
She can come over here and cook if she wanted to.
She can come over here and cook anytime she wants to. I'll learn.
Yes. I mean, it's whatever. You know, so she's going to be just fine. Her tennis career was dwindling anyway.
Yeah.
So to get into answer your other question, do I think she's going to come back in 2 years and be able to play? No. I actually think this might just finish off her career, which is fine. But this is not going to hurt her image.
Yeah.
That's the big thing. And I don't think this should hurt Martavis Bryant's image.
No.
Does it hurt Roger Clemens? Does it hurt Barry Bonds?
Yeah.
Does it hurt Mark McGwire? Yes. But these guys, it should not hurt their image based on the circumstance. And at the end of the day, Greg, that image is what you—that's what you lean on as far as these guys that have, you know, fame and fortune. So to me, she doesn't lose a dime of integrity as far as I'm concerned, and that's what you call owning it up. Andy Pettit did the same thing. Not to belabor this, but Andy Pettit came out and said, "You know what? Yep, I did it.
Yeah,
I'll take my suspension. I'll move on." He didn't even try to play around with it. And guess what? You don't think about Andy Pettit being in the same sentence as McGwire and Bonds and Clemens and, you know, Palmeiro and all those other guys that took steroids, because he owned it.
Yeah, he owned up to his.
That's all you have to do.
Yeah.
That's it.
Having said that, you know, we just talked last week on the show about Peyton Manning and maybe allegations that surrounded him and whether or not he would lose endorsements or, you know, I don't really see Peyton Manning as any different than when he stepped off the field as opposed to when he stepped on the field. I mean, to me, he was still a football player. Of course, those allegations weren't, I don't know if they were true or not, but I think when he pretty much retired last week, he spoke to them, and I think he squashed it. And I think that's about as far as it goes at this point, which might be a little bit different than what we were just talking about. Chad States, by the way, live in Huntington with Greg Banks on theairnetwork.net. It's Monday Night Sports Talk. Normally, Dave is with us. I'm not sure where he's at tonight, but we're going to run this, Chad, because I know you have things that you have to do this evening. So before you have to run, and I'm solo, let me ask you this. Your thoughts on Liriano being named the opening day pitcher for the Pirates. A lot of thought that Gerrit Cole should be given that nod. Instead, the Buccos decide to go with the lefty. Your thoughts on that?
I'm shocked. but this just tells me that you're not going to have Gerrit Cole for long in a Pittsburgh Pirate uniform.
Really?
I mean, Gerrit Cole's your opening day starter. Mm. That's who people are going to want to come to pay to see.
Mm-hmm.
When I went to see a game last year with my father and take him to his first game ever at PNC Park,
yeah,
we wanted to see Gerrit Cole pitch.
Okay.
That's what the fans are paying to see. And the fact that they didn't allow him to be the opening day starter is just beyond ridiculous.
Do you think the Pirates are putting him, you think the Buccos are putting him on notice then? Because that little incident with the pay and the salary and, you know, free agency coming up. And, I mean, obviously there's something amiss in Pirate camp for them to go with Mariano instead of Cole.
I agree with you wholeheartedly. And, you know, I think Pittsburgh's going to miss out on an opportunity here to lock up a great pitcher for a long period of time because of what's happening here. It's just it's one mistake after another with this guy, and I don't know why it's going on, but to me I think that's a laughable incident of what they are doing with Gerrit Cole. He should be your opening day starter, number one ace of the staff, everything like that, and he proved it last year. And they're not doing it. So there's something there.
Yeah, I don't think that's going to happen. So anyhow, we wish them best of luck, the Buccos. As I've been watching some of their exhibition games, you know, Wednesday, it is early yet. You see a lot of minor leaguers getting some playing time. I watched Harrison one night. He looks like he's pretty secure at second base. He looks like he's comfortable. Obviously, the outfield looks half decent. And pitching is questionable, but that's probably a topic for another day as we head into spring training and, of course, opening day. Let me ask you this, Chad. Now, I know I got the brackets last night, and I'm poring over mine, and I haven't really sat down and really got down to the brass tacks yet. There's still a little time yet as to play on play-in games, I guess, or tomorrow, right, for the NCAA.
Yep.
So I did talk with Jimmy Tye, and I'll play that conversation later on in the show, but do you have a pretty solid idea of how your bracket looks? Did you fill yours out already? Is there anybody that you see there that could be a sleeper this year?
My lack of following NCAA basketball this year is incredible. I don't know that I've sat down and watched a full game.
Yeah.
So to tell you that I would know anything about it would be, you know, obviously one of the great fallacies in this whole entire world this year.
Right.
But You know, I do follow sports from the peripheral, and I would have to say that if I had to pick a team, a team that I wouldn't pick against would be more so than the teams that I would pick for, but a team that I wouldn't pick against is Michigan State.
Michigan State,
I'm telling you, I think Tom Izzo is the best college basketball coach going in today's world.
Right.
I think he runs a top-notch program. I think his players are always ready for March, and he's got a great backcourt, and I am not picking against Michigan State, that's for sure.
Okay.
I like Sparty a lot. I also like North Carolina, and forgive me, I don't know if they're on opposite brackets that they could actually meet in a championship game, because I have not looked at it yet. I will be tomorrow.
Yeah, I'm going to go over these brackets with you in just a second, because we'll kind of go in depth here region by region. But North Carolina actually holding down the number one seed in the East. And then when I go down to the Midwest, let's see, Michigan State was ranked number two in the Midwest.
So they would meet in a semifinal?
Yeah, they would actually meet in the, I think they would meet in the Elite Eight. And the East versus the Midwest. And, of course, they would meet in the semifinals, okay? And then, of course, we would have the championship. Let's see. Yeah, I guess that would be semifinals. So let me break this down real quick, and then we have a better understanding. In the South, Kansas was selected number one. In the West, Oregon, which is a surprise to many, selected as number one. In the East region, as I mentioned, you have North Carolina. And in the Midwest, you had Virginia. Now, many folks, there was question about why Virginia would be there, and even Oregon, for that matter, as Oklahoma had a half-decent record in the West, where Oregon came out number one. Kansas, I don't think that was a brainer, no-brainer. North Carolina in the East, not really a no-brainer. But then when you got into the Midwest, these are some of the teams that were included. Number one, Virginia. Number two, Michigan State. Syracuse even showed up at 10th, and I'm not even sure they should have been in the playoff at all. Gonzaga, obviously, and Pitt will be in the, matter of fact, in the Midwest. And let me make sure they're in the Midwest, because I did see Pitt is taking on Wisconsin. And yeah, that'll be in the East regions, by the way, Chad. Now, these play-in games, some of these names may be familiar. Tomorrow, matter of fact, do you have True TV?
Yeah.
Okay. Because I was trying to find it today on my cable. I know it's there somewhere between TNT, maybe TBS.
But I watch it once a year.
Yeah,
tomorrow.
That's the only time. Tomorrow, they'll get those, well, the play-in games. And I don't want to say they're insignificant, because these are the matchups for tomorrow. Vanderbilt takes on Wichita State. Now, we watched Wichita State last year almost shock the entire Final Four. Okay, if you remember. Then we have Holy Cross taking on Southern. Now, I believe Southern was a team where the coach jumped in the air and broke his leg. I could be mistaken there. So, if you're not familiar with Southern. Then you have Michigan taking on Tulane. No, actually, is that Tulsa? Yeah, that's Tulsa. Michigan takes on Tulsa. And then Gulf Coast will take on Fairleigh Dickinson. Is that Fairleigh or Farley? We used to call it Farley.
I call it Farley. Fairleigh. Just in memory of Chris Farley. Just
yeah.
Let it go.
Okay.
Might break some tables or.
Yeah.
We'll call it the Tommy Boy game.
The Tommy Boy game. So that's the play-in as far as the tournament's concerned. And like I said, I don't know. Jimmy and I were trying earlier today to figure out our Final Four. I did basically say Kansas is going to be there. He thinks Arizona will be in there when it's all said and done. North Carolina stands pat, and then it's kind of a toss-up between Virginia and Michigan State, to which I think Jimmy said, and I'll have to check because I'm going to play his back here in a little bit, but I do believe he said Michigan State takes it all.
That's where I'm at.
Okay? I mean, seriously.
I agree with Jimmy. Jimmy's a basketball guru compared to what I am.
Yeah, yeah, Jimmy has some sensibility, and he does watch those games. I got to give him that. You know, it could be he has stats on, like, players I didn't even know were born yet. You know, and it's like, and he tells you, he knows their background. Now, different subject, though, and you and I will talk about that in a moment. When it comes to wrestling, he don't know crap.
Nope.
So, okay. All right, Chad States with us live here. If you were to toss up, let me ask you this, Chad, in that Pitt-Wisconsin game, and I know you don't know much about either one of these teams, although Wisconsin was there last year, okay? Who do you think takes that game?
I'm taking Pitt.
And are you?
And the very few basketball games that I've watched this year,
right?
I've watched some Pitt. I like Jamie Dixon. I think he's a great coach.
Okay.
I really do.
Yeah.
I'm going to take Pitt. I think Pitt has a better team than Wisconsin. I think Wisconsin's one of those teams that, you know, they lost their coach midway through the year.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think we all know why, but you know, he kind of left and they that's a depleted roster compared to what they have last year. I'm going to take the Panthers. I think Jamie Dixon's going to have a hungry team.
You think so? I think they're hungry, too. But you know what? They lacked something after that Duke win. You know, I mean, of course, again, their season was kind of sporadic. They said even in the top four teams this year, they had the most losses, I guess, since 2000. There were like 23 losses among the Final Four, or at least the ones that were rated in their regions, you know. Pitt, you know, they were consistent. You know, there were times early on in the season you didn't think, I thought they were going to get an NIT bid. I really didn't even think they were going to get offered, you know, to the big dance. So I'm just happy that they're there. With any luck, hey, they'll continue on. You know what the greatest matchup would be, though, Chad? If Villanova somehow wins out, I believe their first game, they could actually end up facing Temple. You know what I mean? Because the way that's going down on Thursday, Villanova plays UNC Asheville, and Temple plays Iowa. And if Temple happens to win in that game, they'll face Villanova. Wouldn't that be wild?
Yeah, and that could be a winnable game. Iowa's not played well down the stretch.
Right,
so
haven't
that
they?
Could be a winnable game.
Yeah, but they were one of the majors in the Big Ten at the beginning. Matter of fact, in NCAA basketball, Iowa had ranked rather high throughout most of the season.
Doesn't matter how you begin the season, it matters how you finish it. Well, they're not finishing very well.
The fact that you said that, do you think that maybe Kentucky or even Duke might even appear somewhere down the road?
Yeah,
here?
I don't think Duke will. I think there's too many issues on that team.
Okay.
Kentucky, yeah. I mean, they're playing good right now.
Yeah.
So you never know.
Okay. I mean, I'm just asking. We'll go and delve deeper into these brackets, by the way. I imagine maybe next week, if you're on with us, you can kind of look at your brackets and tell us Of course, by this time last year, we were all out, I think, after the first game. Because I think there were a couple upsets that just blew everybody's brackets. So it'll be interesting to see how it works this year. Let me ask you this. First of all, let's talk a little bit about wrestling. Penn State, the wrestlers head to New York City. And it was said by Cal Sanderson when asked by a reporter, well, what sights are you going to see in New York? To which Cal said, we're going to see the Madison Square Garden. What else were there be to see? In other words, they're going up there on business, man. They're not going sightseeing. Do you kind of like that, what Cal had to tell the reporter, Chad? And what do you think they'll end up doing this year? Winning another national?
Yeah, I love it, and they're bringing home more hardware. Yeah, mm-hmm. They're the best team in the nation. They're the deepest team in the nation.
Oh, yeah.
There's nobody that can compete with their top-end firepower. It's been that way all year long.
Okay.
And I don't see the national tournament being any more of a disappointment for them. I mean, you know, predictively, when you look at it, they're going to send three number one seeds out there. And I don't think that they can really be stopped. It's a machine right now. Mm. And, you know, Cale Sanderson has built a powerhouse by locking down the state of Pennsylvania, and the top recruits don't get out.
Yeah.
That's very evident with, you know, how the front end of his lineup is all Pennsylvania at this point in time, and two on the back end were as well. So, you know, you don't need to look for any further to be able to get the best, athletes in that sport. All you have to do is look in your own backyard, and he secured it. So
yeah.
there shouldn't be any reason why he should not be winning national title number five
and
come Saturday night.
You actually called it last year when you said that Penn State would have a down year last year.
Yep.
By design, really.
But by design. Completely. Yep.
And so when we go into New York this weekend, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, you're seeing, who are the champions? McIntosh?
McIntosh has a great shot at 197. Okay. Rutherford at 149 pounds.
Right.
And then Bo Nickel at 174.
There you go.
You know, at 125, you have Nico Megalutis, who's seated third. I think he can make a final, whether he can, you know, beat the kid that's in the finals this year, whether it's Tomasello or Gilman from Iowa.
Mm-hmm.
That has yet to be seen. But Nico definitely has the ability to be able to make a final at least.
Yeah.
And then as you just go down through the lineup, Penn State has a lot of other All-American candidates that are sitting in there. And, you know, again, it's just it's one right after the other.
Yeah.
And you just don't know what you're going to – I mean, I shouldn't say that. You do know what you're going to get because it's the mark of consistency, which is what that program is noted for.
Yeah. And, you know, interesting enough, I don't want to make this analogy, but I watched AA wrestling on PCN over the weekend in Hershey, and we'll get to that in a moment. There was a kid that actually beat three former state champions on his way to a state champion record on Saturday. I can't remember the kid's name.
His name was Brian Courtney. He was from Athens. And not only did he beat three returning state
that
champions,
was unreal.
He beat three returning state champions in consecutive matches.
You know, and that's unheard of.
It's never happened in the history of PIAA ever. So now when you look back at that bracket, you have four state titlists counting himself in that bracket. It's never happened before. Just a tremendous... I mean, obviously, he was the outstanding wrestler of the tournament and deservedly
so. He deserved that. So, keeping that in mind, when these guys go to New York, I don't care if Michalutis or anybody is ranked third in the country. You know, anything can happen, man, at the NCAAs.
Now, let's say this. Those weren't necessarily all upsets for this kid.
Okay.
This Brian Courtney kid was very, very good at
it. It wasn't like this kid came out of nowhere, right?
No, not at all. This kid's actually going to Cornell. And Cornell's one of the top Division I programs in all of wrestling right now.
If I'm not mistaken.
Everybody looked at this bracket and thought this might be a possibility because this kid is that good.
Okay. Yeah. Now, had he met anybody else, like in maybe one of these tournaments? I mean,
any one of those kids or not, but last year, I believe... Last year, he was either a state runner-up or a state third-place finisher. So that just proves that he has the ability. But it also shows you how deep Pennsylvania is. Because the three kids that he beat will all be wrestling Division I at one point in time.
Exactly. So, yeah. Now, and I understand, I'm not sure, was he a junior this year?
Junior.
Like, he'll be back. So here again, you know, I mean, that was one of the greatest stories out of Hershey on Saturday. And I didn't really watch AAA. But I will tell you this, probably the greatest story out of Hershey was a local story about Jacob Oliver. And maybe you can talk a little bit about that, Chad, for somebody that might just be tuning in to miss the action of that match, how it went into double overtime and then sudden death, and how Jake ended up victorious in that match.
Well, I mean, you know, he poured his heart into it. I will say this, that for the first two tournaments of the year, the district and the Southwest Regional, you didn't see all of what Jake Oliver was able to bring to the table.
Right.
For those who don't know, he was nursing a torn labrum in his left shoulder, and was actually, by the time the district tournament rolled around, he was actually just coming back after a month break of not doing any wrestling really at all. So
right.
He was just kind of getting his feet wet. Enters into the state tournament, having finished third in the regional and second in the state, which is a little uncharacteristic for him, and makes it all the way to the state final, and needing to avenge two previous losses. He beat Anthony Welsh from Best Center in the semifinals, 8-3. Avenging his loss that he had at the Southwest Regional, and then he was able to meet up with the Walters boy from Westmont Hilltop, who
right.
he had lost to in the district final. And you know, it was a back and forth type of match where Walters was able to secure the first takedown in the first period, and then Jake Oliver was able to get a reversal right near the end.
Yeah.
He hit his sitting switch and was able to get the reversal to tie it up 2-2. We go into the second period where Jake was able to get an escape. Walters then secured another takedown and then cut Jake loose.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden, you know, we are tied up and we're going into overtime.
Yeah.
Where it was a back and forth thing for about a minute. All of a sudden, Walters gets deep in on a single leg, and from the standing position, Jake Oliver hits a spladle.
Yeah.
And puts Walters right to his back. Now it wasn't. Like, he had him down there and was holding him for a long period of time, but
yeah.
the ref did award two. Walters got up. They ended the match, and that was that. So it was it was just a tremendous finish to, you know, what many thought was going to be what Jake Oliver should have done to begin with, was become a state champion this
right.
year after finishing as a runner-up last year. So hats off
yeah.
to Jake for powering through an injury, because he basically
yeah.
wrestled with one arm.
Yeah.
And he is now slated to have surgery this week. So for those
okay.
of you who
best
don't know how hard that is, try just putting one arm behind your back and not wrestle, because that's what he did for
yeah.
basically the last 5-6 weeks here.
Exactly. And if recall, refresh my memory, that overtime, the sudden death, were they neutral and he did a takedown?
It was neutral, you know,
okay.
and Walter shot in on Jake's leg.
Right.
And Jake just leaped, just reached right down below, grabbed
that's right.
Walter's leg, and then hit
yeah.
him up with a spladle right there at the end, which is a 2-point takedown.
Yeah, it was a takedown virtually.
And, you know, and
yeah.
it's a takedown.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's what is what it is.
And it happened rather
quickly.
The referee
didn't call that right away because he
yeah.
wanted to let the action continue
yeah.
in case Jake was able to pin the kid from that position,
yes,
which
yes.
he was not.
Yeah.
Walter's flipped out. So,
yeah.
but still, regardless.
You give him two for that because it was a takedown. But here again, this spladle, somebody asked me to explain that to them the other day, and when I saw the picture clearly that you've seen on Facebook, and I'm not sure what that gentleman's name was that took that picture, but you know what? They ought to put that in the largest frame they can and stick that in the trophy case
yep.
at Huntington High School, and probably put it in the state book that Tom Elling does every year for wrestling. But having said that, when he hit them with that spladle, I had a better understanding when it was frozen. It was the old traditional cradle, and he had his leg hooked like a spread eagle at the same time that, you know, I guess your opponent is hard to move out of a move like that. I'm going to tell
yeah,
you what.
And Jake hit it really fast.
Yes,
on
he
him.
Did.
And Walters is a big, strong kid.
Yeah, yeah.
And an athletic kid, so he was mm-hmm. able to rock out of it real quick, but regardless, he got taken down.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
And all you need to do in sudden victory
for
is secure a takedown,
yeah.
and it's over, and that's
yeah.
all he needed to do.
And I think that's where we got the confusion with the coach and the AD hitting us up on Facebook and making comments, and I call him Coach Cal, you know, because Coach Cal didn't understand. It wasn't about the pinning combination. It was the fact that he took him down. That's where
that's
he
right.
got his 2 points, and that's enough said. And so the guy wanted to argue with us, and you sent him home, and he's probably crying now. No, I'm just kidding. I'm only kidding, Cal, if you're listening. Because, you know, he's one of those guys. Well, let me just give you an example of Coach Cal. I love the guy to death. He's like a brother because he did all my events, like on television in Johnstown for 8 years, Game of the Week broadcast on TV. But he's a civics teacher, okay, and he knows everything. And, you know, it's one of those things where he didn't know anything about wrestling. And so I told him, go back and talk to Coach Bojan, and he'll explain to you what that move was. And so he let it go. But let me ask you this. How do the other boys feel, Chad? You had Glorioso, you had Wagner, you had Bainey, you had, some of those guys. I mean, they wrestled their hearts out this season. And I told somebody, I said, these kids are wrestling all year round, man. This is not just like all of a sudden Jake showed up or Glorioso or the rest of them showed up just for the postseason. These guys put in the work, like, even in the spring and summer, don't they?
Yeah, they do. But actually, for this group, Glorioso is a year-round wrestler.
Okay.
Oliver is a year-round wrestler.
Right.
John Wagner is not.
Okay.
John Wagner plays football,
yeah.
Wrestles, and plays baseball. Logan Fisher
Okay. Plays
football. Wrestles and plays baseball.
Cool.
Seth Bainey, who finished fourth in the state,
right,
plays baseball, plays football, and mm-hmm. wrestles. So what you're looking at is you're looking at two individuals, and Tyler Scott, let's not forget him.
Yeah, I wanted to mention Scott,
who
too.
Also made the state tournament as well.
Yeah.
And plays football and wrestles. And so you're looking at a group of kids there, and they don't just play them. They're outstanding at them.
Yeah, yeah.
So you're looking at just some great athletes.
Just athletes.
And great athletes that just happened to be coming along at the same time period to be able to get Huntington five place winners in the state and finish 2 points shy of a state title.
Yeah.
Finishing runner-up is just an absolutely amazing feat for Coach John Mikan and his staff and his team. And just, you know, what a great weekend and what a great way to cap off just what I originally thought was going to be a great season. I kept saying all along, I think this team is a better tournament team than they are a dual meet team. And they went out and they proved it by winning the District 6 tournament, the Southwest Regional, and then finishing runner-up in the state tournament. You know, sometimes you get lucky with your predictions, and I would like to think that this wasn't just luck. It was a little bit more of intuitive skill, just knowing what John had sitting there, because it was just the perfect storm for him to have a great team and a great season.
And I remember you called it from the beginning of the season. You've said Huntington probably should see 4 to 5 kids at the states this year. And you hit that on the – well, actually, they ended up with, what, 5 kids?
Six.
Yeah. So, I mean, that's got to be – and you know what? For the coach, and you know what? He's got to feel great about that because of the fact that, you know what? He's worked with these kids over the years, and he's watched these kids. He got his first state champion. How cool is that? And
well,
then
they don't grow them on trees.
No,
so
they
that's
don't.
Not an easy thing to do.
Now, what happens next year? Now, and I know this is premature, but who comes back next season? Do they have a foundation?
Oh, absolutely. They've got a great foundation. Isaac Benson will be back at 120 pounds. He was the top seed at the district tournament, and then ended up making it to regionals and not being there. But you have Tyler Scott, who was a district champion this year,
right,
and also qualified for states out of the Southwest Regional. You have Seth Bainey, who was a district champion and finished fourth in the state at 145 pounds.
Yeah.
You also have Jake Oliver coming back, too, who obviously we know what his credentials are.
Yeah.
So he's got a great foundation coming back. Now, do I think it will be as good as what this year was? No.
Hmm.
You can't take three seniors that have, you know, done what those kids have done in the program and replace those. So I don't look for Huntington to repeat the same success that they had this year. In fact, I don't know that will ever be done. Just takes a
hey,
special
know what?
Group of kids
we
to
could
get
be,
together.
We could be surprised because, you know what, I got to think that, you know, since Coach Mikan's there and Coach Shea, that or maybe our junior high kids or JOs, if you will, you know, are moving up. And you never know which one of those young guys might be working with Young Guns or Black Dog out of Center County or any one of those clubs, you know? And
you can hope so.
You never know. And there again, I just wish them the best of luck in the future. Did anybody declare, I think you did say, Wagner's going to Lock Haven or
Glorioso will be going to Lock Haven.
Okay.
John Wagner.
Yeah,
was accepted at the Naval Academy.
Oh, that's right.
Which is just an outstanding place for John Wagner to go.
What do you think he'll do there?
Do
you think he'll play football or wrestle?
He's going to wrestle.
Okay.
He's definitely going to wrestle. John could do
both.
He could play baseball there, too, if he wanted to. But John's going to wrestle there, which I think is the wisest choice for him to make.
Mm-hmm.
And just congratulations to just an outstanding kid.
Wow.
In making that decision to just pretty much set himself up for life. Also, for Colin Glorioso and Logan Fisher, just capping off tremendous senior years. Glorioso is going to finish as Huntington's all-time leading win, leader in wins, and just a whole cavalcade of accolades that he has there. And he'll continue his success at Lock Haven University, and I'm sure I will be making the hour and a half drive to be able to go up and see him at my alma mater and, go Bald Eagles at that point in time. So just, again, congratulations to John Mikett and his staff and his team for a job well done.
And you know what? They did us proud, because I can't tell you how proud people were just to follow the team. And, of course, you have something to do with that too, Chad, because you actually broadcast several of their matches for us, especially that District 6 match. Those people are still talking about it to this day. And so we hope to do more of those next season on the airnetwork.net. So thank you as well. And I've said, matter of fact, this weekend, I hope that all the old Matt Cats get together and we have a little reunion like they did at the high school this year for the 100th anniversary of the basketball team. And I don't know how long we've been at it. I think Mr. Reese started wrestling in 64, maybe. But we ought to just have a celebration, you know, and just hang out and encourage our wrestlers. It'd be kind of a cool event. That's all I'm saying. All right, let me ask you this. You probably aren't following the Penguins and have no idea who Sherry or Cullen are. Did you watch the match yesterday, the game against the Rangers, Chad?
I didn't. Sherry and Cullen might as well be a fine cuisine to me right at this point in time, so I did not see them.
Okay, well, listen, the Penguins did win 5-3. Over the Rangers, and that's a good sign, you know, because I know if Dave were here right now, he'd be talking about some of these new cats, like this Matt Cullen, by the way. He's almost 40 years old, and he proved basically, and here comes, I guess, Chad, there you got to go, but anyhow, early in the 18th season as he begins to play, that the Penguins still love him and still need him. So anyhow, Chad, of course, thanks for joining us, man. I know you got to run. But having said that, I will talk to you soon here on Sports Talk, all right?
Yep. Take care, guys.
All right. Thanks again. Appreciate Chad bye. States live from Huntington joining us on Sports Talk. Greg Banks, by the way, solo now, but that's okay because there are a few things that we need to do here before we wrap up this show. As we mentioned, the Penguins winning 5-3 over the Rangers. I just barely touched on something about Matt Cullen, all right? And also I want to mention Connor Sherry, learning how to kind of recognize and seize opportunities, to kind of reveal potential long before they made their NHL debuts. This one guy in December, almost 40 years old, Matt Cullen, proving fairly early in his 18th season in the league, and first with the Penguins, that he still has a knack for crafty, timely contributions. The veteran center and the 5'8", 23-year-old winger emerged as heroes one day after the Penguins announced center Malkin would miss 6 to 8 weeks with a long-term upper body injury. Now, if Dave were here, I would ask him, what do you think the chances are that Malkin makes it back in time, healthy now, for the playoffs? And so that's something that Dave and I could actually address next week because, again, I don't watch a lot of the Penguins games. I do tune in. But Dave knows the intricacies of what the Penguins are all about. Also, their chance to get into the playoffs this year. So hopefully we'll be able to touch on more of that next week here on Monday Night Sports Talk. By the way, if there's something you'd like to chat about, we got some time yet. Give me a call, 814-242-4845. That's our number, 814-242-4845. I can adapt even if I have to do a show by myself. But I do appreciate Chad States jumping in early this evening, and then he has to run. But something I did want to share with you, we called around some folks today just to kind of get their feeling on the upcoming NCAA basketball tournament. Now, as I mentioned before, and this is probably, a no-brainer because you can get the brackets anywhere off of, online sites. You can print them out. And you probably have to have them finished overnight tonight because the play-in games actually happen tomorrow. And we'll see what happens in those games as the week progresses. But the play-in games will be as such. Vanderbilt will be meeting Wichita State. That's the opening round to get into the actual tournament. In addition to them, Holy Cross taking on Southern. Those games, by the way, coming up tomorrow. I believe that's on True TV. And then coming up on Wednesday, We've got Michigan taking on Tulsa, and also Florida Gulf Coast. You remember them from last season. They'll be taking on Fairleigh Dickinson. So those are the actual four games as they play in to see who takes on the other elite and the other folks that are in the league. Now, meanwhile, we did check in with Jimmy Ty, and I will tell you this. Jimmy definitely gave us his predictions. So what we want to do right now is pull this up for you. Here's Jimmy's predictions on what's happening.
In the West. First off, this is the greatest time of the year. I love college basketball, March Madness. But to answer your question, no, I don't think Oregon should have been a number one in the West.
Okay.
That's only one I'm shocked of.
Yeah.
The other three, yes. If I would have picked the number one in the West, it would have been Oklahoma. They were number one in the country for a few weeks. Oregon wasn't. Oregon, yes, they won their conference title. That's the only reason they got the number one seed is because Oregon won their conference title, the Pac-12 title.
Right now, in the Midwest, you had made mention of somebody. Did you think Michigan State should have gone in the Midwest as far as Virginia is their number one seed there?
Yeah, Virginia should have been there. They're a pretty good team. They fought North Carolina head and toe, which is North Carolina's probably one of the better teams in the nation.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, but like what you said, Virginia, they should have been a number two seed. Michigan State should have been a number one seed. That's the only other thing I see. But Kansas and North Carolina, yeah, they're definitely number one seeds.
Okay, so coming out of the South, do you see, let me ask you this, because before we even get into the Final Four, do you see Kansas coming out of the South without any major problem? I'm looking through there and I see UConn, Maryland, maybe Vanderbilt. Villanova's in that segment, in that region as well. So do you feel assured that Kansas comes out in the South as the leading seed?
No.
Who do you see coming out of the South there then?
I have in my Elite Eight in the South region, Kansas versus Arizona.
Okay, so you see that Arizona game going down.
I see Arizona as a stumbling block.
Right.
They have a much bigger front line than what Kansas does. Kansas has they have Perry Ellis, who is an outstanding basketball player, but Arizona, they play a type of defense that Kansas hasn't seen yet, so I see Arizona coming out of that region.
Okay, coming out of the West now, you mentioned that Oregon probably should not be number one, but who do you see coming out of that region? Is it going to be Oklahoma, Oregon, or perhaps even Texas A&M might get a look? What do you think?
Oklahoma and Buddy Hield, the best player in the nation.
Okay.
The 6'6", 6'7", senior
right
from Oklahoma. He's going to lead his – they're going to put that team on his back, and he's going to lead them the whole way.
Okay, so you see Oklahoma coming out of the West. Now, going to the East here, we've got North Carolina coming in rated number one. And I also see in that division – now, Pitt takes on Wisconsin coming up this week. West Virginia's in that fray as well as Kentucky. Who do you see emerging from the East then in the Eastern region?
Tar Heels.
Tar Heels.
Gotta be the Tar Heels.
Okay.
Gotta be Carolina. They are the best team right now in the nation, in my opinion.
Anybody in that category there or that region that you think could burst their bubble, though? I mean, just may sneak in. Because, of course, their first game against Florida Gulf Coast, we know that's probably going to be a wash.
Maybe not. If you think about it, Florida Gulf Coast was that team that everybody back in 2013, everybody's like, oh, Florida Gulf Coast, who are they? That's just a small little school. And they went the whole way to the Sweet 16.
Okay. Well, listen, Pitt plays Wisconsin, so you don't think they're actually going to emerge in this region getting past Wisconsin? Or do you think maybe they'll grab one?
Well, I'm a homer, so I'm going to say yes, Pitt's going to win. Wisconsin was the elite team last year. They went the whole way to the championship game. But if you look at what Wisconsin lost last year, they lost two first-round draft picks. That really hurt them. They finished in the middle of the Big Ten Conference.
Yeah.
With Jamel Artis, Michael Young, and James Robinson have to be on their game against Wisconsin. And I can see them playing in the next round against Xavier.
Okay, so anyhow, at this point, East looks like North Carolina. Let's go to the Midwest, Jimmy, real quick. Virginia emerges number one in that region. And Michigan State's in the fray as well. Who do you see coming out of the Midwest in the Final Four here?
Michigan State.
Michigan State does indeed win that bracket at least.
Yeah, I have in my Final Four, I have North Carolina versus Michigan State.
Okay.
Then I have Arizona as my shocker. I always do that. I always put one team that's a shocker in. Mm-hmm. Arizona versus Oklahoma.
Oklahoma. And then who do you see in the championship? Because we're going to go back and take a look and see how these people fared next Monday. Who do you see ends up the winner between, I think you said it was Kansas. Or no, you said the shocker was Arizona and Oklahoma. Who wins that game?
Oklahoma versus Michigan State in the national championship
game. Okay, so that's your final then. You're sticking to that, right? Oklahoma and Oklahoma. Michigan State.
Yes.
All right, Jimmy. So now are you putting any money on your bracket this year? Don't you play like business pools or anything like that?
Well, we're not allowed at work.
But, right.
What I do is my sister Gina back in Pittsburgh has her thing with her corporation. So yeah. I do it through them.
Oh, okay.
And I've been doing that for the past, like, 12 years since she's been working there, so.
Oh, okay, cool. Well, hopefully you win a little money, man, but I'm going to hold you to it. I'm holding you to it, the Michigan State versus Oklahoma in the finals then, right?
Yeah, but I will say this. You have to look at a couple dark horses in the tournament. Hawaii.
Okay.
Hawaii's a good... I sort of like the University of Hawaii Fighting Rainbows or whatever they're called, the Rainbows.
Okay. Yeah.
And they always say you have to have a 12. There's always a 12-5 upset.
Okay.
That's what they always say. There's always a 12-5 upset in the tournament. And this year, the 12-5 upset I have is South Dakota State beating Maryland.
All right. And those are your sleepers, as picked by Jimmy Tye, live via Skype tonight on Monday Night Sports Talk from Hamburg, right?
Yep, and you have University of North Carolina, Wilmington, first-round upset of the Duke Blue Devils. That's the other upset I have going in.
All right, well, we'll see how you fare, Jimmy, because we'll get back in touch with you, whether you're on the show live with us next Monday night, or I'll catch you earlier in the day and get your prediction and see how this whole thing shakes out, okay?
All righty.
Jimmy Tye. Only Jimmy. Hey, I'm glad I didn't say it. I say some bonehead things, you know, from time to time on this show and also middays in Racedown Country, Monday through Friday from 10 to noon. I may as well throw in a plug, but Jimmy, when he said, he said fighting rainbows. Okay, I'm not so sure. I'm going to Google that and find out what Hawaii's nickname is. I don't imagine they have a fighting rainbow as their mascot. How the hell do you have a fighting rainbow? Okay, Jimmy, I'm going to Google that. But he likes Hawaii, nonetheless. All right. Okay, take a deep breath, man. Hold on a second. 814-242-4845. I'm glad I saved that to last. Because I was laughing so hard. 814-242-4845. That's the number if you want to call in and maybe give us your bracket. But again, remember, everything gets underway tomorrow and Wednesday with those play-in games that I mentioned. Vanderbilt taking on Wichita State. Holy Cross taking on Southern. Then on Wednesday, Michigan faces Tulsa. And Florida Gulf Coast takes on Farley Dickinson. All right. And for those of you that were upset that Mammoth did not make it in this year, I don't even know where Mammoth is. Wait a second. I think it's in New Jersey. All right. Hey, I didn't say I was a sport expert. I just like sports, okay? So I try to pay attention to everything. I even watched that golf match yesterday that went into sudden death, okay, on NBC as they were picking the brackets yesterday and going around the country on the other channel, on CBS. I was switching back and forth. Anyhow, these are your first ranked teams in these regions in the NCAA tournament. Kansas, of course, number one in the South. Oregon, number one in the West. Number one in the East is North Carolina. And number one in the Midwest is Virginia. Okay, just in case you weren't paying attention. As Chad and I said, and also Jimmy said earlier today, Michigan State could come out of the Midwest, you know, and that would not be a surprise. Now, keep in mind, Pittsburgh is in. They're taking on Wisconsin. I believe that game is on Thursday. West Virginia, if you're a West Virginia Mountaineer fan, they take on Stephen F. Austin on Thursday. No relation to the guy that runs this corporation, okay? Looking over in the South again, oh, here's that school again, Austin Peay, and I'm not even sure, it's got to be somewhere in Austin, but Maryland is in that region as well, so they could make a threat against Kansas. But here's the cool one, coming up, I believe, on Wednesday, or make that Thursday, Villanova takes on UNC Asheville. Meanwhile, Temple takes on Iowa. Now, if Temple wins their game and Villanova wins their game, yeah, you got a Pennsylvania connection there. And I was watching yesterday when they were doing the brackets on CBS, and they were talking to Jay Wright, the coach at Villanova. Is there a Villanova, Pennsylvania? I thought the actual school was like in Philadelphia. Okay. But anyhow, they, you know, they put like the graphics up, like from where they are emanating the satellite signal, and it kept saying Villanova, Pennsylvania. I'm like, I've never heard of the town, but I've heard of the school. I thought the school was somewhere near Philadelphia, but I could be wrong. Here's one of the factors, and I want to share this with you before we wrap up this edition of Monday Night Sports Talk. We do it every Monday night, 7 to 8 p.m. live with rebroadcasts. Oh, let's see, we'll rebroadcast this show tonight around, should we rebroadcast it at 9? Yeah, I think we'll do it at 9 because we have the other talk show on from 10 to midnight. But anyhow, here's a factor. This is seriously the year of the senior. Yeah, you know, in the NCAAs. This is the year you'll see probably more seniors than you've seen at any other given time in recent history. Only because if you're half decent and you're a sophomore or a junior, you're bailing. You're going for the money in the NBA. Well, some guys have stuck it out 4 years. Hence, guys like Marcus Paige, who's stuck it out for North Carolina for 4 years. And he now, of course, is in one of the top-rated teams in the nation, if not the top-rated teams. But also, keep in mind some of these other names. There's Perry Ellis at Kansas. There's also Georges Niang at Iowa State. Jared Uthoff or Uthoff at Iowa. Melvin Johnson from Virginia. Also, some of the National Player of the Year races in recent history, with two seniors competing, featuring Oklahoma's Buddy Held and Michigan State's Denzel Valentine. So you're going to see a lot of seniors in this tournament, probably for the first time in many years, and perhaps after this year, perhaps the last time, only because normally these guys are going for the bucks. All right, so as Jimmy amused us near the end of the show tonight, I appreciate him. I appreciate Chad States jumping on with us tonight via Skype. Another edition of Monday Night Sports Talk in the books. Hey, we'll do it again coming up next Monday night, live from 7 to 8 p.m. online and on TuneIn. You can always just give us a call if you like to on our studio lines. You can chat about sports as well. And it's all coming from Huntingdon, Pennsylvania. I'm going to have to check out that Hawaii rainbow. I think he's just making that up. Hey, have a good one. See you back here next Monday. I should have said the fighting rainbows. I didn't know rainbows could fight.